Welcome back, everyone. We're here at the Pixel Core Studio, and we're looking at motion and doing some more lighting effects.
Yeah, we've been doing a lot of stuff with lighting, and I saw a question about making neon lights in motion. So I want to show how to do this. There's a lot to do. I'm going to do part of it here, but let's dive right in. I want to show people this works. This is what we're going to make, is this blinking neon light effect against a brick wall here. And we're going to use 3D text to do it. So what I'm going to do, I have a project here that started a little bit. I've got some text in here. And if I bring up the heads up display, you can see the font I'm using here is called Pacifico. But there's many different fonts. You want to find something that lends itself well to neon tubes, right?
Sure.
You can go on fontschool.com, and there's lots of places for free commercial use fonts that you can get. This is the particular one I happen to be using. And my approach here is to use 3D. So I'm going to actually come a little closer and look at this. Right now this is 2D text, but I really want to make 3D tubes to put the light inside.
Sure.
I think kind of literally like this about this stuff. So I'm going to go to the text inspector and enable 3D text. And immediately we get this extruded kind of text.
Right.
But I want it to be round. And you can round the front edge, but you still get this thickness here. So the trick here is to take the depth all the way down to zero.
Right.
And then increase the roundness of the front edge. I think 18 works pretty well here. That gives me pretty well-rounded.
Looks kind of starting to look like tubes.
Yeah, the idea is to get it pretty tube-looking.
Right.
Tubular.
Yeah.
Something like
Very
that.
Very tubular, yeah.
Something about like that. So that gets the basic shape. The next thing I want to do is deal with the material. And I'm going to start with a preset that gets me close. So I'm going to use these materials presets in the pop-up menu here. I'm going to go to miscellaneous. And miscellaneous has some weird ones that you usually think, what am I ever going to use this for? And I'm going to use the one called soap bubble. Which I mean, you know, what would you ever use?
It's kind of random, yeah.
But I use that, and we get this cool, sort of semi-transparent look here.
Yeah.
But I'm just using that as a starting point. The cool thing about soap bubble, it uses this layer property called emit, which is pretty rare. It's not used in most of these presets, but emit actually emits light. It makes it basically glow. By default, it's emitting light from a texture, but I'm just going to use a color here. And depending on what you want it to glow, I'm going to make it kind of a red glow. And this is going to be the outside of my tube. It's not going to be the interior element of glowing, but it's going to be the outside tube. So I'll do something kind of red like that. I can play with the coverage, which then blocks the tubes, which I don't want. I want some transparency because I'm going to have filaments basically inside there. It looks like filaments
right.
If you look at what neon kind of looks like. So I'm going to keep that coverage pretty low. I don't need the distress. I'm going to turn it off. I don't need the polish. But under the reflective paint layer, and we have many other tutorials that talk about the details. I'm sort of going pretty quickly here because we've built up over multiple layers. So this one called reflective paint has a really interesting property called Fresnel. And notice if I drag on the Fresnel, it basically affects the transparency and how the edges bleed in.
Yeah.
So I can really control exactly. This is going to be the edge of the glowing.
Right.
Okay, so I've got these tubes that look pretty tubular there. So to finish this part of it off, I'm going to go to my shortcut for filters. I'm going to go to glow and use this new Glint filter that came out last year, which I love.
Right.
You don't need it just for text, but it works on a lot of different
things. Wow, look at that.
Yeah, it really does a neat effect. What I'm going to do is make the softness. It has this glint size, but I don't want really those streaks. I want to increase the softness. So it kind of has a soft glow. I'm going to increase the intensity. I don't want to go too high, but a nice good glow there. Glint size a little bit. I can play with the exposure. So now I have this nice glowing tube, and I want to put the background behind it. Now this was kind of neat. In 3D text, 3D text doesn't really interact with environment. You can't just throw a layer behind there with 3D text. So I'm going to use a trick by creating a wall out of a piece of text.
Right.
Okay. So what I'm going to do is get T for the text tool, click in the canvas, and then I have a shortcut for my emoji and symbols up here. If you don't, you can turn it on in preferences or under the edit menu, you can choose emoji and symbols. Either way, brings up this palette. I'm going to add this little square and escape. And I've got this little square, which is way too small. I'm going to go ahead and go to the properties and move it in the center and go to the text inspector to the format. I'm going to scale this thing way up, make it a much bigger, much, much bigger object. And I got to kind of drag it down because I want it to fill the whole screen. So this is something where I'm using a piece of text purely as a, for a texture, because it will interact with other 3D text layers. So command left bracket will move it behind the neon. And then in the text inspector, for its appearance, I'm going to enable 3D text. And then I'll go back down to my materials here. And I'm going to go back to miscellaneous. And this time I'm going to choose this red brick material.
Nice.
And there we have red brick, but it's
huge.
Yeah, it's huge. And I don't want that. So here's another trick that you won't find out on your own very easily. But if you go down to the substance, I don't need these custom bumps. I don't need this custom specular. I'm going to show the substance. And if we scroll down, it says that the placement, if I open this up, is called shared because it's connected to the bumps in the specular. But I'm going to make it independent because that gives me scale properties.
Ah.
Okay, and by doing that, I'm going to type in 25. And it just lets me scale those bricks down to something a little more reasonable in size. So we're getting somewhere, but I don't like how they're uniformly lit. So I'm going to go to the lighting environment for the 3D text. I'm going to turn off the environment so it's not reflecting an environment. I'm actually going to turn off the lighting completely because I'm going to use motions lights. You can see in this group here, I've already thrown in some lights. And if I turn those on, in fact, rather than choose, I'll just show you quickly. I'll go to the object menu. I'll add a new light. And that light I can use to pretend to be the neon lighting up the screen. I can make it more intense, and I can color it. And that makes it look like that neon glow is lighting up the canvas behind it. Those are the key tricks. I'm not going to do more in the building here, but I'll go back to my finished project just to show you what I did to get the full effect here. Is to get the neon inside the tubes, I drew with a Bezier tool paths for each of the letters. And then on those, each of those paths, I simply used an outline and then added the glint filter to it.
Right.
So nothing different there. And that gave me the inside part. And then to make the glow turn on and off, I added a wriggle parameter behavior to the text itself, and it wriggles the opacity. You can see it's right here, it's applied to the opacity. So the text turns on and off, and then I've copied that onto each of these other layers here. And then if we look at the lights, and I'll option click to open up all the layers in there, I have a link behavior applied to each of the lights that links their opacity right here to the opacity of the text layer. So they all move together in tandem. And by doing that, the lights turn on and off at the same time as the neon to make it look like the neon's affecting the wall. And I added a light when the neon's turned off. I added a light above. We can see a little bit of a light. I've got a spotlight at the top just so we still see a little bit of a light for the rest of it. So that was a little more work of just copying things on there. But the basic technique is using 3D text and using the fact that you can link different behaviors together.
That's a whole lot of layers, my friend.
Yes. So I think what we'll do is we'll post this so people can download it for themselves. And I think we'll have something on the website where people can get it. If you don't use Bezier paths, you could save this as an effect and use it in Final Cut. So we'll also make a version that's a little different than this that you can use in Final Cut Pro.
Excellent. It'll give you more work when we finally deliver this MacBreak, who knows, 10 weeks from now,
Whatever.
Right,
it'll be ready by then.
Exactly. All right.
So in the links below, you should see links to Motion Project, Final Cut plugin, links to the Ripple site to get this stuff, because we're happy to share it with you. Maybe you can improve on it.
And speaking of which, watch our YouTube channel. He's got a lot of great motion content, tons of it. And of course, Ripple Training for feature length motion tutorials where you learn about 3D text, particles, cameras, the whole thing. Follow us on Twitter, Facebook, and we'll see you next week on another episode of MacBreak Studio.